Hello everyone and welcome back to Easy Dentistry, a channel that makes dental education incredibly easy. I hope you all are enjoying our lectures on dental material. You can check our playlist on dental materials and view all the important topics. But before that, please subscribe to our channel, comment and let us know your feedback about our lectures. Do share these videos with all your friends, and if you like, please smash that thumbs up icon so that we know if you are liking or not liking the videos. So today's topic is the second part of the chapter Dental Amalgam. We have already uploaded part 1. Please watch part 1 of Dental Amalgam first before we proceed with this lecture for better understanding of the topic. So the link of the part Dental Amalgam part 1 is given in the description box. You can check that. So in this part 2, we will be studying about the manufacturing of the alloy particles. There are two types of alloy particles. These are the spherical and the lathe cut. So we will be discussing about how these are manufactured. Then we will be studying about the low copper alloys, its setting reaction and microstructure. Then we would be studying about the high copper alloys, which are again of two types, the admixed one and the single composition one. We will be discussing the composition of each of these, the setting reaction and the microstructure. Then we will be discussing some of the most important properties of dental amalgam, which will include micro leakage, dimensional change, the effect of moisture contamination, the strength of the dental amalgam and the creep properties of the dental amalgam. These properties of dental amalgam is very important topic, which is asked as a short answer question, and many MCQs are also can be asked from this entire topic of dental amalgam. So please watch these lectures very carefully and in sequence, that is first the part 1, then this part 2, and further I'll be uploading the part 3, which would be the concluding part of the dental amalgam. So let's begin with today's topic. So the first part we will be discussing is how the manufacturing of the alloy particles take place. So the alloy particles are of two types, the lathe cut one and the spherical one. Depending upon the shape, the alloy particles are of two types, the lathe cut and the spherical. So how are these lathe cut alloy particles manufactured? Firstly, all the ingredient metals are molten together. This is the molten form of the ingredient metals. And these molten metals are then poured into a mold to form an ingot. And this mold is cooled slowly to form the ingot. Now this ingot of the core structure contains non-homogeneous grains. So, because of this disadvantage of having non-homogeneous grains in the ingot, the ingot is heated slowly up to 400 degrees Celsius for 6 to 8 hours, which leads to the formation of annealed ingot. And this slow heating of the ingot results in formation of more homogeneous grains of the alloy particles. Now this annealed ingot or heated ingot is subjected to milling machine or a lathe machine to form needle-like chips. Now these needle-like chips are further processed by ball milling to form the chip-sized particles or the lathe-cut particles. And this is how the lathe-cut alloy particles are made. Now these lathe-cut alloy particles go through numerous processes of ball milling and other things. So these lathe cut alloy particles are under stress. So these Stressed lathe cut alloy particles undergo rapid reaction with mercury. This rapid reaction is not desirable, so we need to reduce the stress of these lathe cut alloy particles. So how is the stress of the alloy particles reduced? Storage of the particles under room temperature reduces this reactivity. This process of storage of the alloy particles is also known as aging of alloy. This aging of alloy is desirable to reduce the reactivity and to increase the shelf life of the alloy particles. Now, there is a concept called as quick aging. What is this? Quick aging of the alloy particles can be done by boiling the alloy particles in water for 30 minutes or by acid wash. So, by these easy procedures, the aging can of the alloy particles can be quickened. So, this is called as the quick aging. Now, we have discussed how the lathe cut alloy particles are produced. Now, let us see how the spherical alloy particles are manufactured. These spherical alloy particles are manufactured by a process called as atomization. So, let us study this process of atomization in detail. Now, in the process of atomization, the molten metals are sprayed under high pressure of inert gas in a large chamber. This is a chamber and it is under high pressure. Now, the molten metals are sprayed into this chamber under high pressure, and when if the droplets of these molten metals solidify before hitting any of these surfaces of the chamber, we get spherical shaped alloy particles. So this process is called as atomization. Now, the mode of supply of alloy particles is in the form of powder or disposable capsules or pre-weighed tablets or pellets. We have already learned in part 1 dental amalgam the classification of amalgam alloys. So based on the copper content, the alloys are classified as low copper alloys and high copper alloys. Now let us study the setting reaction and the microstructure of the set product of both these low copper as well as high copper alloys. Now the low copper alloys, the composition includes silver 63% to 70%, tin 26% to 28%, copper 2% to 5%, and zinc 0% to 2%. Now, silver tin alloy particles of the low copper alloy is called as the gamma phase. Remember this, the silver tin alloy particles are called as the gamma phase. Now, these silver tin alloy particles react with mercury, and silver and tin on the outer surface of these alloy particles, they dissolve into mercury, and mercury also penetrates into the interior of these alloy particles, resulting in formation of two phases, the gamma 1 phase and the gamma 2 phase. The gamma 1 phase is the silver mercury phase, while the gamma 2 phase is the tin mercury phase. Let me repeat, when these alloy particles of silver and tin are combined with mercury, silver tin particles on the surface, the silver and tin present on the surface of these particles, on the surface, the silver and tin, it dissolves into mercury with the mercury. Also, the mercury penetrates into the interior of these particles for further reaction, resulting in formation of two phases, the gamma 1, which is silver mercury phase, and the gamma 2, which is the tin mercury phase. So, the gamma phase is the silver tin phase, the gamma 1 phase is the silver mercury phase, and gamma 2 is the tin mercury phase. Remember all these phases, which are very important for all of you. So please remember, it is asked frequently in exams. Gamma phase is the silver tin alloy particles. The gamma 1 phase is the silver mercury phase and the gamma 2 phase is the tin mercury phase. Now, as the crystals of the gamma 1 and gamma 2 are formed, first, initially, the material is soft and can be condensed into the cavity. As more and more gamma 1 and gamma 2 phases are formed, the material becomes hard. And there is 27% unreacted alloy particles, that is the gamma phase, present in the said product. So, if the microstructure is seen, the set mass consists of unreacted gamma particles surrounded by a matrix of gamma 1 and gamma 2. You can see the unreacted gamma particles surrounded by the gamma 1 phase and the gamma 2 phase. Also, voids are seen in the matrix between the gamma 1 and gamma 2 phase, which are formed in between the crystals of the two phases. Now, the interface between this gamma phase and the gamma 1, gamma 2 phases is very important. The unconsumed gamma phase should bond to this matrix. This interface is very important. There should be bonding between the two to increase the strength of the final product. So, this interface is important. Now, the physical properties of the hardened amalgam depend upon the relative percentage of each phase. More the unreacted alloy particles, the stronger is the end product. More the gamma 2 phase, the more there is corrosion. This gamma 2 phase is very weak, so it leads to corrosion if present in large amount. So here we have completed the discussion of low copper alloys. Let us now see the high copper alloys. These high copper alloys are the material of choice because they increase the mechanical properties, they have more corrosion resistance, and they have better marginal integrity. So there are two types of high copper alloys, the admixed one and the single composition one. The admixed one, as the name says, it is a mixture of more than of two or more different alloy different metals, so it is called as the admixed alloys. They were introduced in 1963. The total copper content is between 9 to 20 weight percent. Composition of admixed high copper alloys is 69% silver, 17% tin, 13% copper and 1% zinc. The silver copper eutectic alloy and the silver tin alloy is present in the ratio of 1:2. So this silver copper eutectic alloy is made up of high copper spherical particles, while the silver tin alloy is made up of low copper lathe cut particles, and they are present in the ratio of 1:2. So the combination of these two is called as the admixed alloy. So what is the meaning of the word eutectic alloy? A eutectic alloy is one in which the components exhibit complete liquid solubility and limited solid solubility. For example, the silver copper phase exhibit a eutectic structure at silver 71.9% and copper 28.1%. Now, these admixed high copper alloys are more stronger because the silver copper phase acts as fillers in between the phases, and this increase the strength. Now, the composition of the admixed high copper alloys is silver 69%, tin 17%, copper 13% and zinc 1%. Now let us study the setting reaction of the admixed alloys. There are two types of alloy particles present in the admixed alloy, the silver copper and the silver tin. When mixed with mercury, the silver dissolves from the silver copper particles, and both silver and tin dissolves from the silver tin particles with the mercury, and there is formation of the gamma phase, gamma 1 and gamma 2 phase. Now in these admixed alloys, this gamma 2 phase or the tin mercury phase then combines with the silver copper particles of the alloy, resulting in the formation of the eta phase or the copper tin phase. Cu6SN5 is the eta phase. Plus, so the final product is made up of the eta phase and the gamma 1 phase. The gamma 2, it combines with the silver copper particles to form the eta phase. So the final product is made up of the unreacted alloy particles, the gamma 1 phase and the eta phase. The gamma 2 phase is replaced by the eta phase. Hope this is clear, because this concept is very, very important. So in the setting reaction, the gamma 2 phase is eliminated, and because this gamma 2 phase is highly susceptible to corrosion, because of its elimination, there is increased resistance to corrosion. The copper content for this reaction should be at least 12%. So the microstructure of the admixed alloy contains the unreacted alloy particles and a matrix of the gamma 1 phase and the silver copper particles, which are surrounded by the eta phase. So this is the microstructure of the admixed alloys. Now the single composition alloys. The composition includes 46 to 60% silver, 22 to 30% tin, copper 13 to 30% and zinc 0 to 4%. So as the name indicates, the single composition alloys contain only one type of alloy particles. These are the spherical particles of 5 to 40 micrometer size. Now the setting reaction, silver and tin dissolves into mercury. Also very little copper dissolves in the mercury. And the resulting reaction is, there is presence of gamma 1 phase and the eta phase, they form around the unreacted alloy particles. So there is a matrix of the gamma 1 phase and there is the unreacted alloy particles surrounded by the copper tin phase or the eta phase. So in the single composition alloy particles also, the gamma 2 phase is eliminated. But there is a difference in how the gamma 2 phase is eliminated in admixed and single composition alloys. Let us see how. In admixed alloys, the gamma 2 phase forms around the Ag3SN phase and is eliminated around the silver copper phase. While in the single composition or the unicompositional alloy, at the beginning of the reaction, the alloy particles behave as silver tin particles, while in the later reaction, the same particles behave as silver copper particles and the gamma 2 phase is eliminated. Now let us study the properties of amalgam. Now the dental amalgam is unique in some properties, and because of these unique properties, it differs from other alloys. Certain important properties to study are, first the micro leakage, then the dimensional change, then the effect of moisture contamination, then the strength, and lastly the creep. So the micro leakage, very important topic asked frequently in exams, so study this carefully. So we know that only GIC, that is glass ionomer cement, and the polycarboxylate cement chemically bond with tooth structure. Other material do not bond with tooth structure. So if this is a tooth with this filling material present which do not bond chemically with the tooth structure, there is penetration of fluid from this micro gap present between this filling and the tooth structure. This is the micro gap. So there is penetration of these fluids in this gap, and because of the penetration of these fluids, there is formation of secondary caries around the restoration. But the dental amalgam has an exceptional clinical performance. There is reduced tendency of micro leakage in these dental amalgam. How? At the interface between the amalgam restoration and the tooth structure, there is formation of corrosion products. And due to this formation of corrosion products, there is sealing of the interface. This interface is sealed by the formation of corrosion products. This interface is totally sealed, and because of this sealing of the interface, there is less incidence of secondary caries. So the micro leakage component of the amalgam restoration is reduced. Now the second property is the dimensional change. Ideally, the dimensional change in any restoration should be very, very minimal. Excessive contraction may result in a small gap between the restoration and the tooth, which results in secondary caries. Also, excessive expansion may result into increased pulpal pressure, increased sensitivity, and protrusion of the restoration from the prepared cavity. So according to the ADA specification number 1, the dimensional change, either the expansion or the contraction, should not be more than 20 micrometer at 37 degree Celsius, 5 minutes to 24 hours after insertion of the material into the cavity. Now let us study the theory of dimensional change. When alloy is mixed with mercury, there is formation of the gamma 1 matrix. Now the final volume of this gamma 1 matrix which is formed is less than the volume of the alloy and mercury which is used for trituration. Now this difference in the volume of the two results in contraction of the final product. Now this contraction will continue till the growth of gamma 1 crystals. As the gamma 1 crystals, they grow, they impinge with one another to cause an outward pressure. These are the growing gamma 1 crystals. They impinge with one another and produce an outward pressure. If sufficient mercury is present to provide the plastic matrix, an expansion will occur when gamma 1 crystals impinge. If sufficient mercury is present in between, they provide a plastic matrix, and an expansion will occur when gamma 1 crystals impinge. Now these gamma 1 crystals, they consume this mercury present in between them, resulting into the continued reaction. Now, if insufficient mercury is present, there is contraction of the final product, and if sufficient mercury is present between the interstitial spaces between the gamma 1 crystals, if the interstitial space contains sufficient mercury, it results into expansion of the final product. Also, increased condensation pressure squeezes out mercury from the restoration, and this results into decreased residual mercury and results in contraction. Also, manipulative procedures that reduces the mercury content are the increased trituration time and small alloy particle size. If the alloy particle size is small, there is larger surface area per unit mass. So more mercury is consumed and no excess mercury is present for further reaction. So the modern amalgams show overall contraction while the older amalgams show expansion. Let us see how. In older amalgams, there is increase in the alloy particle size and increase in the mercury alloy ratio, and they are hand triturated. So they undergo expansion. Also, in modern amalgam, they are mixed with the use of high speed amalgamators, so they undergo contraction. Now let us study the effect of moisture contamination on the dental amalgam. Now, if a zinc containing alloy, remember only a zinc containing alloy because zinc plays a major role here, if it is contaminated by moisture during trituration or condensation, large amount of expansion occurs. Now this expansion may be up to 400 micrometer or 4%, and this expansion is called as delayed or the secondary expansion. Now let us see what causes this secondary or delayed expansion. The zinc present in the alloy particles, if they react with water, they form zinc oxide and release of hydrogen gas. Now this hydrogen gas, it does not combine with amalgam, but it collects within the restoration, causing increased internal pressure, expansion of the amalgam and protrusion of the restoration out of the cavity. Now, because of this accumulation of the hydrogen gas, there is increased creep, increased micro leakage. There is pitted surface to the restoration. There is more corrosion, pain and fracture of the restoration. But you should remember that if the moisture contamination occurs during trituration or condensation, then only delayed expansion may occur. But after condensation, if the external surface of this restoration come in contact with the saliva, there is no delayed expansion. And also, zinc is very important for the delayed expansion. The alloys which do not contain the zinc will not show delayed expansion. Now let us study an important property, which is strength. More strength is a primary requisite for dental amalgam. The satisfactory compressive strength of the amalgam is 310 MPa or 45,000 PSI. The compressive strength of low copper amalgam in 1 hour is 145 MPa and after 7 days it is 343 MPa, while the admixed high copper alloy have a compressive strength of 137 MPa in 1 hour and 431 MPa in 7 days, while the single composition alloys have a compressive strength of 262 MPa in 1 hour and 510 MPa in 7 days. Also, the tensile strength of the amalgam is less than that of compressive strength. It is only 48 to 70 MPa. Both the high copper and low copper amalgam shows the same tensile strength, that is between 48 to 70 MPa. So the cavity preparation of the dental amalgam should be such that it should be subjected to least tensile forces. Now, what are the factors affecting strength? The first factor is the trituration. The type of alloy, the trituration time and the speed of amalgamation, it affects the strength of the amalgam. Both decrease in trituration or increase in the trituration decreases the strength. The second factor is the mercury content. If the mercury content is reduced, there is formation of a dry granular mix which causes a pitted surface to the restoration, it decreases the strength and increases the chances of corrosion. More mercury will lead to less strength of the final restoration. Now, the strength of the amalgam depends upon the unconsumed alloy particles. More the unconsumed alloy particles, more is the strength. It also depends upon the mercury content. This mercury containing phases are weak and they decrease the strength. Also, if the mercury content is reduced, then the alloy particles, there is increase in the alloy particles and resulting into decreased matrix phases, and this overall increases the strength. But if the mercury content is more, the alloy particles which are used is less, and there is increased matrix phases, and this increased matrix phases result into the low strength. The third factor affecting strength is condensation. The condensation pressure, the condensation technique, and the alloy particle shape affect the properties of the amalgam. The lathe cut alloy particles increase condensation pressure, increases the compressive strength, because the increased condensation pressure, it reduces the porosity. So more mercury is expelled out, so decreased matrix phases are formed. While in the spherical alloy particles, light pressure is sufficient for adequate strength. The fourth factor is the porosity. Presence of porosity reduces the strength of the amalgam. If there is, the porosity is also related to plasticity. If there is decreased plasticity in the mix, then there is more chances of porosity. The pores are centers for stress concentration, cracks propagation, and corrosion. These pores, they reduces the strength. More condensation pressure also reduces the porosity. Under trituration, under condensation, irregular shaped particles, and if large increments are used to fill the cavity, there is increased chance of porosity. The fifth factor is the rate of hardening. Amalgam do not gain strength as rapidly as desired. At the end of 20 minutes, which is the time at which the patient is dismissed from the dental chair, the compressive strength is only 6% of the 1 week strength. At 1 hour, the compressive strength is 80 MPa, while at 8 hours, it is 70% compressive strength is gained. So the patient is advised not to subject the restoration to biting forces for at least 8 hours, because at 8 hours, 70% of the compressive strength is gained. Also, the high copper single composition alloy have 1 hour compressive strength of 262 MPa, and in 6 months, this strength gradually increases as the reaction continues. The last property of dental amalgam we will be studying today is the creep. Creep is defined as the time-dependent plastic deformation. Increased creep results in increased marginal deterioration. According to ADA specification number 1, the creep should be less than 3%. The low copper amalgams have a creep ranging between 0.8 to 8%, while the high copper amalgam have a creep between 0.4 to 1%. Low copper amalgam show increased volume of gamma 1 phase, which increases the creep. If there is increase in the size of the gamma 1 grains, there is decreased creep, and gamma 2 phase, it increases the creep. In single composition high copper alloys, there is elimination of the gamma 2 phase. So this results in the decreased creep. Also, eta phase, which is formed, reduces the creep. Other factors affecting creep are the mercury alloy ratio, which should be minimum. increased condensation pressure for lathe cut or admixed alloys, it reduces the creep. Over or under trituration and delayed condensation also increases the creep. So here we complete the part 2 of the chapter dental amalgam. The next part, that is part 3, which is the concluding part, will be uploaded very soon. Please subscribe to us. Now it is a time to solve a small quiz. The first question today is, atomization forms what part shape of the alloy particles? Question number 2, the tin mercury phase is also known as which phase? And the last question, in high copper alloys, the gamma 2 phase is replaced by which phase? So that's all for now. Please subscribe to us if you have not yet done, and happy studying.